Hello explorers and welcome to another video. Today I'm going to talk a little bit about how to build Android application on Travis CI. And in my case, I have this Squirrel project that I'm working on at the moment. I'm trying to build an Android client. I have some instrumentation tests that I need to run and actually verify that I have accessibility working and so on. And I also want it to be linted, so I check the accessibility there and also check that I don't have any real errors in my code. And then I wanted to have this as an automated test, so I actually could have pull requests later on, and those pull requests could be tested before I actually review and merge them. So in order to set up Travis CI, you need to have a Travis YAML file. So this is a configuration file for the Travis CI running an environment, and Travis CI is implemented into GitHub. So if you have an account at Travis CI and you have your GitHub set up, you can actually just switch on which repositories you want to run Travis CI on, and then you just have to have a configuration file and everything will just work for you. So it's a very nice thing to have. And if you are building something that is totally open source, it's free on Travis CI. If you are building something that is closed source, you will pay a little amount for them to run your code and test it. To set it up first, here we have what kind of language it is. In this case, it's an Android application, so they actually have an Android language. Seems a little bit weird, but okay. Then I say that I want a JDK, so I want JDK 8. And this sudo flag here, you can either have sudo false, true, or required. And in my case, I put it to false. And if you are putting it to false, Travis will most probably put your thing into a Docker environment. But if you have sudo requirements, then they will not put you into a Docker environment. Then you will have a little bit more permissions in the system. But in my case, I didn't need that. And then I set some global variables for my build script here. So I have an API level, so that's something that I want to install. I have an emulator level, and in this case I have a different emulator level than I actually build for. So in this case I choose 18, and this is a little bit interesting. Both emulator level and Android ABI is something that you need to keep in mind, because you need to find an actual Android image that it is available. So you have to choose those from a list. And then I also use an Android tag of Google APIs, and that's also a thing used to find your specific image to run. Then we have this Android build tools. It's pretty self-explanatory. And I set my install timeout to 20 minutes, because it can take a while and I don't want it to break and actually crash if it's not done in time. And then I set that my QMU, which is the running environment for the specific image, so that's the virtual environment that you run Android in, and I want to say that my audio driver there should be none, so I don't need audio for my tests. And then we come to the actual components that you need in my Android build. So first I need the tools. These are the build tools and things that are more general tools for the Android platform. So not the build tools, the general tools. And then I need the platform tools. And then I install the tools again. And this can seem a little bit weird, but in the first case, you install the tools for Android version 23, I believe. And if you want the latest tools, then you have to run this command again to get the actual tools. And then I run build tools, so I can install this 2703 tools. And then I install Android for both my API level and the emulator level. And most of these component namings that you see here corresponds to the names that you can see in the Android installer in the Android Studio. So if you have looked at that installer plugin or installer setup in Android Studio, you will pretty much have the same namings as in that dialog. And then I install the extra Android support because I use design and some other support libraries. And then I want the Google repository and the Android repository if I would like to get even more packages during my build. And this is my system image. I have the system image, and then I have this ARM ABI V7A. So that's the Android ABI. And then Google API, so I could actually have the tag down here as well. And then the emulator level. So these are the things I need to specify to find a specific image. And how do I know which images are available? There is actually an XML file that will be downloaded that have all the system images. So that's available at dlgoogle.com, Android repository, system image, Google APIs, system image XML. And this little thing here, I also have it in my README file for the Squirrel project, so you can find it there if you like. And here you have, after four tags full of license text, you actually have definitions. So you have a system image here, you see that you have an API level of 10 in this case, and then you see revision and a description and the size and so on. And then you have the ABI down here. So this is a ARM ABI V7A and it's Google APIs. So you can look down here and see that here I have my number 18. So this is available. I could also choose to run number 17 with x86, and it's also available with ARM. So if you look in this XML file, you can actually find what's available for you. And I was trying to run the very latest, and I found out that number 27, for instance, only have an x86 version, and I really wanted to run it on the ARM platform because the ARM images seems to be a little bit more stable and they actually start every time. Sometimes these x86 or x86 underscore 64 doesn't start in Travis CI for some reason. So I would recommend running ARM for the moment. I don't really know why, but that seems to be more stable. And then we define some licenses. So I have the Android preview license. Might not be required because I'm not installing that that API. And then we have the SDK license for both Google and Android, the standard licenses. We set up some cache directories. These are not required, but your build can be a little bit faster if you have those defined. And then before I do my install, I install CMake. So that's required to actually build my project. I need CMake. And then I get the Android NDK because I have some native libraries that needs to be built. I unzip those. I define where the Android NDK home is, and also put that into my path. I create a license directory and put some licenses into that, into different files in that directory. So that's for the NDK, so it can actually find the files that specifies that you have accepted the licenses. So these things I just copy and pasted from the internet, and these are different for each build of the NDK. So if you want to run this, you need to find such definition and copy paste it in to actually have it running on your system. Or just find my repository and copy paste them from my install if you want to use. At the moment, our release 16 beta, I think that's the latest at the moment, but that could change as this video gets older. And then before I run my script, I list which Android targets are available, and that's just so I can see if things go bad. I can see that my Android image actually was loaded and is available. So then it should be in the list of targets. And then you create an Android running environment, so a virtual environment for the Android image. So this is what you say here. I force it. I call it test. And then I say which tag I should use, and ABI and tag. And then I start the emulator with the AVD that I installed earlier with no window, because I don't need a window to run my tests. And then I wait for my emulator to come up. I run the build dependency check and analyze and build. So this is to check that everything is available and also that it can build. And then I have this little row down here that I run ADB shell input key event 82. And this is to tell the running environment that you should unlock yourself, because now I will do something in the actual, I will run some tests that actually needs it to be unlocked. So this will unlock your device. So the next test you can run is run on an unlocked device. And then I run a connected check, and I disable pre-dex. I have read that that should make things faster. I don't know if it's required. And then I want to stack traces if anything goes wrong. And after failure, if you have some linting errors, it could be nice to actually cut the XML of lint results, so you can actually read what kind of lint errors that you got, if that's the case. So this is the script I'm running at the moment. It's a little bit buggy. I would want it to be more reliable and actually make a good result every time, or if there is actually an error, it would fail. But I haven't really come to the conclusion what is wrong with this script that makes it unreliable. So if you have any suggestion, please tell me in the comments section below. This is the best Travis script for Android that I have come up with so far, and I have scoured the internet for tips and tricks and so on. So I hope that this will give you a jump start if you need to set up an Android build on Travis CI for your project. I hope that you found this video interesting. I hope that you learned something today. If you like this video, please give it a like, share it with your friends and colleagues. If you have any question at all, please write a comment down below. If you haven't subscribed yet, please do that. And I really hope to see you in the next video.